going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV. This is the YouTube channel for dog lovers. What's up, Tasty Dragon? Can you guys hear me okay? All right, guys, how's it going? Try to figure this out real quick. I am actually in the midst of trying something new. So let's try this out. Tonight, I'm gonna be talking live. We'll have a live conversation. And it's basically gonna be centered around dog parks as opposed to play dates. So if you guys want to talk to me, I'm going to limit my responses to folks in the who are basically, you know, sticking to the subject at hand, which is the dog parks as opposed to play dates. I'm just going to lay it out right now. I'm not a big fan of dog parks. I find that when you take your dog to a dog park, there's like there's no quality control for your dog's engagement. You don't know what dogs are gonna be there that your dog is gonna have to deal with, which in some situations could be a good thing, could be a positive thing, could build confidence in your dog. If your dog, you know, doesn't, oh, you guys can't hear me very well. Let's see what's going on with that. Let's see. Is anyone else having an issue hearing my audio? Let me see something here. Let's see. Check. Is that any better? Is that better for the audio? Give me a heads up, somebody talk to me about the audio. Like I said, I'm doing something new right now. I'm actually, okay, perfect. I'm gonna turn it all the way up. It's a tad low. I'm gonna turn it all the way up. Let me see. Check. Is that any better? Check. All right, cool. It's still better, right? Okay, perfect. All right, perfect. I'm doing it a little different. Sometimes I do the lives from my phone. Sometimes I do the live with the microphone that's on the computer. This time I'm actually using you can see right here, this microphone here, which is a little bit nicer, hopefully a better quality sound. I still haven't worked out the kinks to how I'm going to do these live events just yet. You know, I'm always tinkering with things. That's part of my problem as an artist. I'm always tinkering with things. So it works out to be a good thing sometimes, and sometimes it's not so good. I'm going to turn the TV off in the background because, okay, Google, turn off the TV. Because I don't want to get like, okay, Google, turn off the TV. Yeah, I don't want to get any copyright issues with that TV back there. It is ESPN Sports Center for me right now. That's the time of day it is. or should I say the time of night. Sounds a little slight on the right side of the headphones. You know what, bro? I'm gonna work on this a little bit more. Sound only on the right side of the headphones. But only in the right ear. I don't know. Let's see, let me try one more thing. We can tweak this out a little bit higher. Let's see. Balance. All right, we're gonna probably, let's see if I can fix this. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to fix this. Let me just see. Control, streaming, let's see. Scarlet. Check. It is on the right side. I see that. All right, guys, you're gonna have to maybe just let's just deal with it for now. I don't want to stop the flow. I will work on this more and more. Like I said, I am a tinkerer, and I am. I just wanted to do this because I don't want to keep making excuses for not doing these live. These live things, these live events, and just kind of, you know, with the holidays coming and all that other stuff, I'm having a lot more time. My kids are like out of school right now, and my schedule's changing. I have a lot of time. I have a lot of videos that I am going to shoot over the next couple of weeks, but by the end of the year. In addition, I will be trying to do live events that support the videos. So this video today, I'm talking about dog parks versus playdates. This video directly ties into the video I just posted, Bad Boys for Life, with the Rottweiler and the Doberman. That Rottweiler is my Rottweiler. That's Roscoe. You can see him. He's back there in the corner. He's like a shadow sleeping on that bed back there. And then a friend of mine, his name is Gerald, who I met through by doing Dogumentary TV. I've known him for a few years now, so I do call him a friend. A real cool dude. He has a Doberman Pinscher that he imported from Russia. His name is Sigmund. So we went out yesterday, and I enjoyed it so much. You know, my kids actually showed up. My wife and my kids showed up, so I kind of squeezed my kids into the video. And I was excited after shooting it. I didn't have to get up early in the morning to take my kids to school, so I stayed up late working on it, and then I finished the video today. But what I will do is, and we'll get to the question and answers in a second. I'm probably going to lose this thing in a second, but this little thing right here. But no, what I want you guys to understand is that for me, the way I've been dealing with Roscoe, and even when I dealt with Bernie when he was younger, and I still deal with him, I don't take my dogs to dog parks. Took Bernie to a dog park when I first got him. I used to take him regularly, and he would do great if all the dogs in the dog park were big. And there was a rule at the dog park that they had a big dog park. They had a section of the park was that section was for bigger dogs. Then there was a section for tiny dogs. It always seemed like the people who had the tiny dogs felt like their dogs could, you know, play with the big dogs and it would be cool. My dog Bernie had a lot of prey drive, and he would always get into something and get into things. So, you know, I didn't really take him to the dog park that much. And actually I just stopped taking him because he got into a big like scuffle. It wasn't that he started the fight, but a fight started and then he involved himself, and it was just an ugly situation. You know, he's got some pit bull in him. So once he got into that fight, he literally didn't want to get out of the fight. And once I've kind of extracted him from the fight, It took me a good 4 or 5 weeks to get him to stop wanting to fight dogs. I mean, every dog he saw, it was like, let me fight. Like, he just, because he had never been in a fight before, it was like a switch was flipped. And so when you go to the dog park, you know, you got a lot of different philosophies in terms of dog ownership. You know, I try to be a very much calm, assertive dog owner. Some people tend to be, a lot of people can be passive. A lot of people can believe that their dogs can do no wrong. They want their dogs to be free. They want their dogs to, you know, have no limitations, no boundaries. And they want you to be cool with that, you know. And I'm not going to ever really own a dog that doesn't have a certain level of, what's the word, assertiveness. You know, I'm a big dog kind of person. So I just went from a pit bull mix to a Rottweiler. And I can even, if you guys seen any of the footage that's on Roscoe's channel, Roscoe has a problem already when dogs bark at him. He doesn't back down. He's going to engage. He hasn't been in a fight. That's a great thing. But he's not afraid. When dogs fence fight with him, he's very interested in going to the fence and seeing what that is about. So if he's at a dog park and there's no fence, either he's going to fight or he's going to be beaten up. I don't know, because he's not going to avoid the situation. He's very interested and intrigued by that kind of commotion. But if you can see, like, he's not a dog aggressive dog right now anyway. As a puppy, I've taken him around tons of dogs and done play dates. He's had a play date with a border collie. He did a play date with a Doberman Pinscher. He always has, you know, hangs out with Bernie in the house. He's hung around another Rottweiler, a giant schnauzer. He's been around a lot of, he's been around my in-law's little puppy. So he's been around a lot of dogs. And I just feel like moving forward as a recommendation, I'm going to suggest that people stay away from dog parks and that they form little communities where they can actually find like-minded dog owners. Like, if you're a free and clear, my dog can be do no wrong, that might not be a bad way to be if you can find other people who raise their dogs that way and their dogs aren't aggressive or their dogs are, I guess, passive, I guess would be the better. I don't know. Like, I mean, honestly, I'm not a big proponent of being free and clear in regards to your dogs. I'm a big believer in being assertive, providing boundaries, providing limitations, proper amount of exercise. So for me, I have to find people who are like-minded. Gerald is like-minded. So it took a little while for Roscoe and Sigmund to get to know each other. But, you know, after 15 or 20 minutes, you know, they both freed up, and it was basically, you know, easy peasy, you know, if that's a word. So I just wanted to, at this point, now I'm going to take your questions. Now we can have a conversation. We have a dialogue. If you guys want to share any dog park experiences that you've had that were good, bad, if you believe in dog parks, you want to be a proponent of that in this conversation, feel free to leave the comments. It's 9:14 now. I'm going to go for another 30 minutes, so probably to like 9:45. We can just talk about it. But you guys know my position now. I'm not for dog parks as a means of exercising your dogs. A bigger proponent of actually creating a smaller community of like-minded dog people with like-minded dogs that get together and have recreation for their dogs. So, all right, guys. So now I'm going to turn my attention to the to your comments. I haven't been paying attention as much. So if you ask me a question regarding dog parks or play dates, I'll answer those now. I'll engage those now. If you have a question that isn't necessarily about dog parks and play dates, because that's the point of this video, even though I noticed that that's not what it says in the title, I just realized that. I'm doing it a different way today, so just please excuse it. I will figure this out and get it done right. All right, guys, I'm starting to look right now, and I see Umar Karizi. Have you had a lot of experience with different dog breeds? What do you think is the most versatile honey dog breed? So, again, that's not necessarily about dog parks and dog and play dates. But Umair, because no one else is, I haven't seen anything else. You're the first one off. I will answer that question. And I will say this in terms of hunting breeds, you know, there's a lot of different, there's a lot of different ways dog breeds hunt. You know, a Labrador Retriever can be considered a hunting breed. A Fila can be considered a hunting breed. A Cane Corso can be considered a hunting breed. So I need to know what kind of hunting are you talking about? Are you talking about retrieving? You're talking about pointing? You're talking about catching? You're talking about baying? What kind of hunting are you talking about? What is a dog doing? All right, Tiffany said, I'm not a fan of small off-leash dog park. Tiffany is stunting on all of us because she, I guess she's saying she has 90 acres of property, which we all should be a little bit envious of. But hey, you know, it's all good. Tiffany, show off. How do you get an antisocial dog to play with other dogs? Now, again, I'm not a dog trainer, but what I would suggest is that you basically, the first thing I would do is introduce, what I would do, and like I said, I'm not a dog trainer, but this is what I would do. This is what I do with my, and I'm not saying that it works greatly, but it does work in a way. Like, so my in-laws, they have a little dog. He's really yappy, very antisocial. Whenever I want him to get along with Bernie, the first thing I do is I take him on a long walk. I put both of them on a leash. I control both of them. Both of them know that I'm in control. You know, he's not going to mess with you. He's not going to mess with you. Or the other one's not going to mess with you. And the cool thing about taking them on a long walk is, you know, most dogs at that point, they begin to, and since they're moving, they engage their environment. They engage their nose. They engage their senses. They relieve themselves. They do what they typically do when they're out and about. And then, you know, at some point you bring them back in to a, your yard, your backyard, your fence yard or whatever, and you just let them, you need to stay there and you need to just monitor their behavior. Now, an antisocial dog might not ever become like a social dog, meaning he might not ever figure out how to play or the sniffing routine, the sniffing rituals that dogs have with each other. So we shouldn't necessarily expect that every dog is going to be, you know, the life of a party. But every dog should be able to be comfortable in the presence of other dogs. Well, we hope that they can be comfortable in the presence of other dogs. So I wouldn't necessarily push the issue, but I would, you know, first and foremost, you know, take them on a long walk together, let them kind of move and get used to each other's presence, and then just give them some supervised recreation. If your dog is antisocial but he loves a ball, I mean, at some point once you feel like he's comfortable with the other dog around, throw the ball around and see if that loosens him up and then allows him and the other dog to figure out ways to play. And I would start that out small, like one-on-one. Once he gets comfortable with one dog, then maybe do two dogs and then three dogs and then four dogs. That would be my strategy. But if you really want some professional help, find a professional. All right. So what's popping, Maine? All right. That's what's up. Off topic, if you could, Dr. Frankenstein, Dr. Swinford, what kind of super dog would you create? Size, color, temperament. What breeds to cross? Leather Channel. All right, I mean, I'm going to be honest with you, bro. I'm not a big person on hybrid. I feel like at the end of the day, and this might sound a little self-serving or self-affirming, I guess might be the word, is I think the Rottweiler is a perfect dog, bro. Like, I can't even front. Like, I am 100% totally satisfied with the Rottweiler. And that's simply because it fits my life and what I'm doing with my life. Not to say that, you know, if I had other things I had to do, like if I was hunting, I would have to get another dog. That's just the reality of it. And at that point, I may want to cross dogs. But, you know, because I'm doing what I do and how I'm living my life, Rottweiler is a perfect dog for me. I don't see any need to get anything else. And there are a lot of dogs like that. The Cane Corso, I think, is almost the perfect dog. I mean, it would be perfect if there was no Rottweiler. Bull Mastiffs, again, you know, there's a lot of great dogs out there. we've as a race, human beings, we have created a lot of amazing and versatile dog breeds. I don't necessarily believe that we need to be creating any more. That's just my opinion. Let's see. Not a fan of dog parks either. Irresponsible dog owners. A lot of irresponsible dog owners out there groom. Oh, Tiffany has a 90 acre dog park near her house. Well, that's cool. Like 90 acres, that's huge. That's a lot of dog. That's a lot of space. You could lose a dog on 90 acres. You gotta be careful. When is the bully cutter video coming out? It's off topic. But because it is, you know, in line with, you know, Bully Badass TV, in line with documentary TV programming, I'm trying to have that video drop the day before Thanksgiving. It's pretty much done right now. It's a longer video. It's a more complicated video than the video I just dropped yesterday. So it takes me a little bit longer to figure out how to, you know, get all this stuff together, get all the information organized and make sense. But it'll be out within the next 2 days, trust me. Definitely won't be out. It'll be out before the weekend for sure. Redno said, can you bring back the bullies to your channel? I missed that. No, maybe, we'll see. I just did a bully video, Redno. And I just today, and it's not bullies, I guess, per se. What I did today, just to hopefully next month, early next month, I'll be filming some Amstaffs. If that can kind of help you out a little bit, if you kind of want to see that. I mean, I am filming Amstaffs, so. Do you introduce Roscoe to other animals like cats, chickens, goats, etc.? You know what? I hadn't even thought about that. Goats, chickens. He has been introduced to sheep. And he has been introduced to other dogs. That's it. I don't have any chickens or things like that around here. That's an interesting idea though. Like, would it make a difference to him? Or at this point, I don't think. Well, at this point, he does have a high prey drive. He loves to chase things. He loves to chase. So that could be an issue. I don't think he's ready to bite and kill anything right now, but he would definitely chase probably chickens and cats and all that stuff. Zeke, when are you doing a video about bulldogs? We're going to pass on that right now. I take my pit bull to the park often, socializing. It helps a lot. I mean, I think taking them to the park, it might help a lot, but it could also be very destructive, you know, because at some point, like I said, my dog got into a fight at the park because two other dogs were fighting. And once he saw what was going on, he kind of intervened, and then he got bit. And then he was like, okay, well, let's bite. And then, you know, so I think, you know, a much more efficient way other than going to a dog park would be to find, four or five like-minded people with four or five dogs. And you guys get together and you guys allow your dogs to get to know each other and play and all that stuff. And that way, you just, to me, I would just feel more at ease in a situation like that than as opposed to going to a place where there's a bunch of strangers, a bunch of strange dogs. I see a bunch of bad behavior and a bunch of bad guidance. That'll make me nervous. So, I'm again, if the dog park is working for you, that's a good thing, I guess. It doesn't work for me, and I'm recommending that serious dog people get themselves together, create communities where their dogs can actually have safe, exciting, and positive recreation. All right, K Doodle, not all dogs are social. Don't push it. That's very truthful. That's a great point. I probably should have thought about that, in a sense that, you know, some breeds are solitary. That's how they work. That's where they come from. And some specific dogs within a breed could just have, you know, not be social. And that's very true. They could just love their people. Like, I can honestly say Bernie is not a social dog. Like, if he will play with Roscoe if you put a dog in his place, in his space, well, now that he's gotten older, he would just rather be around people. I'll just say that. Like, he's not as, you know, if you bring a dog in the house, like Roscoe, you know, I guess he figured he was here to stay. After a while, he would play with him. And he would, you know, engage him. And I guess it had also to do with the fact that Roscoe was a puppy, and Roscoe was very attached to him. In a sense that, you know, Roscoe would sleep on him, share. If you guys seen my Instagram, you know that they have, you know, Roscoe's always, when he was a puppy, was always in Bernie's bed and wouldn't let Bernie have any peace. But, you know, Bernie understood that he was our dog. He was my dog now. He was going to be in the house, and there was nothing he could do about it. So he just accepted it. So that was a great point. All dogs are not social. Let's see, we're going to the next question. Kay Doolittle, not a social right. Ravi Chandra. More about Caucasian Shepherds. Okay, that's off topic. Okay, Luna, the Corso. My County Corso will get along with some dogs, but doesn't click with many. And that's perfect. That's the perfect point, is that, like, you know, that's why you want to basically select who you're, you know, you're asking your dog to interact with. You want to make sure that person that dog and the dog's owner are like-minded, you know, meaning that they kind of have the same social structure in terms of, you know, providing limitations, you know, being able to stop when told to stop, things like that, understanding space and not, like, you know, crowding spaces. I've seen, I did see this at a dog park. Like, it was a super happy golden retriever. It was just running around, jumping around, bouncing off walls or whatever. Like, just bouncing off everything. Benches, other dogs, people. He bounced off of this woman, and she had, like, some kind of pit bull mix, like a pit bull master mix. No, that dog saw the golden retriever hit her, or, like, kind of, like, just up and paw, like, paws into her midsection. He took off, you know? And he was on that dog like within like 2 seconds. I didn't have a dog at the park at that time. I was actually there just filming dog footage. So I had to put my camera down and help these people get this dog off of this golden retriever. And, you know, that's kind of another lesson that I've learned, you know, from going to dog parks, that, you know, you kind of got it. And a woman who owned the golden retriever just thought it was like, oh, look at him. He's having so much fun. He's so excited. Like, dude, get your dog. All right, let's go forward. High Desert Homesteader, do you have any videos of American Band Dog Massive? I don't have any videos of American Band Dog Massive. I actually was supposed to go out to Mississippi last week to film some American Band Dogs, or just film some band dogs, I guess. But I just couldn't get it together in time. I had so much going on with my kids getting out of school and the holidays coming up. I just couldn't make the time to get out there. Pote Luz, what's up, my brother? How's it going? Kaya Miller, I personally never took my pit mix to the dog park. I've been debating whether to. She's very social, playful with other dogs, even gets along with other pit bull breeds perfectly fine. I mean, so Kaya, I would suggest, you know, create a small community with her of dogs and find a space for them to play, you know, because, you know, like at the dog park, you just never know who you're going to bump into. You never know how people are raising their dogs, you know. So let's go down a little bit more. Do you know any intimidating runners for dogs? That's off topic. So, guys, just so you guys know, the topic right now is basically we're talking about dog parks versus play dates, you know, sharing your experiences that you've had at the dog parks, as well as, you know, the idea that I have of creating a smaller community, a smaller group of like-minded dog owners and dog breeds to get together and hang out with. Would probably be a much safer and productive way to exercise your dog. Sweet Lass says, I get too anxious with taking my East German Shepherd to the dog park. We don't know the other dogs. A playdate seems more manageable, you know. And that's exactly my point, Sweet Lass. Ooh, that's a name I never thought I would ever say. Sweet Lass. What's up, Sweet Lass? What's up, Sweet Lass? You the man. Name five dog park. All right, more New York City. Name five dogs for beginners. Off topic, but I'm gonna do it only because you guys seem to want to know a lot about beginners. I think obviously Labrador Retriever, Golden Retriever, any retriever is basically good for a first-time dog owner. You just got to be ready to run. And the good thing about a retriever is they will retrieve. So all you really have to do is find a piece of land and sit still and just keep throwing things and let them retrieve it. They'll run themselves out. They'll get tired. Maybe you might have switched up with their retrieving and the directions and all that stuff, but they will run after things and bring them back to you. So any retriever, you know, whether it be Golden, Chesapeake Bay, flat-coated, Labrador Retriever, those are all probably good dogs for beginners. excuse me. Collab with Thompson. Who's that? Are they Oaktown? I will do a Boston Terrier video as soon as I can find someone with Boston Terriers out here that wants to film. I've been trying to do a Boston Terrier video for some time now. Thank you, Tiffany. I appreciate that. Gerald had some hairspray that he was spraying on the dogs. He was so, man, these dogs are going to shine. These dogs are going to shine. Roscoe does get regular baths, you know, once a month. I'm going to credit the shine on that in that video to the fact that Gerald was like a canine makeup artist, you know, cleaning the dogs up, and making sure they sparkled. Let's see. What do you have to say about the special service dog that Trump talked about today? Well, I'm gonna say this, and this is off topic, but I do want to talk about this because I did see that, and I'm gonna be honest with you. That's a Belgian Malinois that's like, obviously, that's working at elite levels. I'm a firm believer, but seeing that dog on like on the podium or on stage with the president and all those other people, I'm a big believer that they sedated that dog. Cause like, I've never seen a Belgian Malinois that chill. Like even if you go by like a police dog, and I mean a police dog is not a Navy SEAL canine. You know what I'm saying? So, but I've never seen a Navy SEAL canine, but I can't believe that they're just that relaxed. So, I mean, obviously the dog did its job. That's the beautiful thing about dogs. They kind of do their job. But to me, it was the one thing that stuck out to me was like, I can't believe that, like, that dog is just sitting there chilling as these people talk and present it with an award. So I believe my suspicion is that he was sedated. But, you know, I give him all the props in the world. I'm sure he is a wonderful dog and probably a great companion for his military partner. I don't know how they do it with the SEALs, though. They might not partner them up, but I'm almost certain that they do. Let's see. I'm trying to get to you guys' questions. We got about 10 more minutes, so let me just rush through this stuff. And again, the whole point of this talk today was to talk about dog parks versus play groups, play dates for dogs. What do you think is the best, this is Andy Flowers, what do you think is the best way to break up a dog fight at a dog park with large breeds? Man, I mean, that's kind of the reason why I don't go to dog parks, because I don't want to have to figure out how do you break up a fight with, with large dog breeds at a dog park. I was walking a friend's Rottweiler, and he got into a fight with a pit bull, a game pit bull like that. I mean, well, he was, I don't know if he was game, I don't know how game he was, but he was about like 47, 48 pounds. He was a small dog, ripped like to shreds. But he was chilling with a golden retriever. So I don't know what, you know, I don't know if he had any aggressiveness in him or not. But when they got to fighting, it was almost impossible to remove the bites, you know. So the Rottweiler was held on to the pit bull, and the pit bull was holding on to the Rottweiler. And I don't know how long the fight lasted. I felt like it lasted 2 hours, because I was, for however long it lasted, I was trying to pull the Rottweiler off of the pit bull. The guy who owned the pit bull was kind of crazy in the sense that he actually stuck his hands into his dog's mouth and kind of tried to release his grip on the dog, which I thought was like the dumbest thing ever. And I don't think it really worked. I think eventually both of the dogs got tired and they released themselves. So other than maybe bringing like a brake stick to a dog park with you, which seems sort of like, you know, kind of counterintuitive to taking your dog to a dog park, I don't know how you break up a dog fight. If you think you're going to just throw water on them and that's going to do the trick, I wouldn't bet on that. So I don't know. That's a tough answer. That's a tough question right there. Let's keep going on. Down the next 7 minutes. There's a pit bull that is always tries to help my dog, and my dog is passive about it and will even start wrestling with him. Yeah, I don't. Saladin, I don't like that sexual. It's dominance, really, probably. But you know, to me, helping on it, this to me, it becomes sexual dominance. It's just like I hate that stuff. So, again, another reason why I don't take my dogs to dogs parks. Let's see. Do you take Roscoe to the store to socialize him? I have taken Roscoe to Home Depot on several occasions, and I've taken him. There are not a lot of stores that you can, you know, when he was a puppy, I would take him to the pet store, obviously. And I can still take him to the pet store. Whenever I go to the Petco or PetSmart, whatever I'm doing, I'll take Roscoe with me. And I've taken him to Home Depot. The other thing I want to say is that it is also very important to socialize your dog. So if you're saying like, oh, I don't want to take my dog to a dog park, that does not absolve you of the fact that you still need to socialize your dog with other dogs. Dogs have a language, a body language, a scent language, and all these other, even vocal languages that they speak to one another. And every dog should be kind of somewhat aware of and comfortable with talking to other dogs. So even if you don't take your dog to a dog park, you gotta definitely socialize your dog and make sure that they you know, they're comfortable around other dogs. All right, so Tiffany, I'm just reading this real quick. I see she has an answer for you on how to break up a dog fight, which I think I just lost it. So she says, sorry, two people grabbed the hind legs, which I've heard, but it doesn't work with pit bulls, I can tell you that right now. Stick your finger up the rectum. Dog releases. Pull dogs apart. Oh, my God. Ooh, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's two things I've never, well, listen. Oh, man. I never, ever, like, some things that you should never, ever think is going to be part of your life. And, like, sticking your finger in a dog's butt. Well, you know, listen, some people have to do it. I mean, vets have to do it, I guess. People take, you know, fecal samples all the time. I don't know that they use their finger. And I'm definitely sure if they use their finger, they have a glove on. Yeah, that's how you're going to get them out the fight, though. Then you got to get them out the fight. So, Andy, get ready. If you ever see two big dogs fighting, man, get someone to lift the legs up and you get to poke it, my brother. All right, that's the end of my jokes for tonight. Let's go on. Should you set a play date? So, my ideal space for play date is a garden, which I don't say gardens. We don't say that in the States, but I had a couple of people from, I guess, England or Europe, somewhere in Europe, was like, oh, my garden is about, you know, such and such big. So a backyard, a front yard, fenced-in area for sure. If you're going to do a play date out in public, then I'm going to suggest that you keep the dogs leashed. And that could be a cool thing, too. Like, for example, a play date could be, you know, taking two dogs to Home Depot or taking two dogs downtown and walking them through downtown. Those could be great play dates. They aren't necessarily great play dates for, like, burning a dog's energy, maybe. But, you know, intellectually, like, mentally, it would probably be a lot for a dog to deal with and to kind of understand the stimulation of going downtown or being around a lot of people. And stuff like that. Let's see. I keep losing my space in this thing. Lunar, of course, I'm taking it to 100. Let's see. All right, guys, we're coming up on the end of this. Sweet lads always step into dog poop at the dog park. It never fails. I'm going to be honest with you. If you go to a dog park and there's poop still on the ground, that is like the height of disrespect. When I live downtown, and people would let their dogs poop in the street and, like, walk away from it, I would immediately, like, call it to their attention. Listen, you know, this is downtown. There are people walking around all the time. There are bags on each corner. You need to get you a bag. You need to get your dog's poop about the street. It just makes sense that we don't want people walking around in poop. And to go to a dog park, well, like I said, everyone should be aware of the dangers of stepping in poop. Everyone should be aware of the the considerations that dog owners have for other people. Pick up the poop, you know what I'm saying? So that's to me, a dog park, dog poop at a dog park, totally unexcusable. Everybody in there is a dog owner. Everybody in there should be watching their dog. Everybody in there should be picking up after their dog. Plain and simple. Let's see. I'm just trying to get to the end of this, guys. So I definitely need to get in the house. So my kids are still up. They're out of school for the Thanksgiving holiday. So I told them I'd be in by 10 o'clock to watch a movie with them. They get to stay up late. Let's see. Nate Otis, he said, I have a five and a half month old Doberman, and that's the same age as my dog. So what day was he born? That would be cool to know. And he loves to play with other dogs, sometimes too much. Is there some way to get him to chill out when around other puppies and dogs? He normally overwhelms the other pup. So what I do, because Roscoe can be like that, you know, and honestly, like Roscoe, when he first met Sigmund, was a little like, he's super hyper, right? Like I said, Roscoe's like super confident, he's super hyper. He lives with a dog that's like 12 years old that basically allows him to do whatever he wants to do. And very seldom does he get like checked for it. Bernie will check him, but Roscoe knows how to read Bernie. So he will push and push and push. I notice he pushes and pushes and pushes up until the point where Bernie's about to snap at him. And then he lays off. But with other dogs, that can be way too much. So what I did with Roscoe was before, you know, we basically took Sigmund, put him away for a second, and I just ran Roscoe, just threw the ball, threw the ball, threw the ball, got him tired. So that by the time he met Sigmund, he did get another boost of energy, and he was again obnoxious and obnoxious and obnoxious. But he was not, it didn't last long. And then once he kind of got calm and he calmed himself down, they were perfect together. So what I would do is, you know, basically exercise a dog that's going to be super super aggressive or super excited, I guess is a better word. Not aggressive, but super excited. Calm his butt down. Run him. Walk him. Do some obedience training. Get him to the point where he's, you know, he's a little worn out. Hey, Z, I just got here. When is the Dobie Roddy video coming? Bro, it came about 4 hours ago. It's been up, man. So not so silently. No, the not so silent majority. You got to go back. You got to dig in a crate, man. It's just one video back. Boom. You'll see this video. Yeah, 4 hours ago. All right, so let's keep going real quick. I'm trying to get to the end of this. I want to thank all you guys again for, you know, hanging out with me. I'm 3 minutes over time. I gotta get going, find a really low energy dog and set a play date with him, go from there. You guys, and if you guys ask questions, read all the comments, because some people are giving some great answers to some of your questions. I hate dog parks. A lot of people need to exercise their dog before taking them to the dog parks. Very cool, very true, Benjamin. Dog parks are babysitting. Yeah, dog parks are babysitting, and this is for Jody Frederick, without the babysitter. Dog parks are like prison yards. You know, they just, excuse my language. Ooh, did I just curse on documentary TV? There's no cursing on documentary TV. My bad. They're basically, some people just like turn their dogs loose in the yard. That's how they look at it. And what happens, happens. All right, guys. So we're coming to the end of this. I definitely want to get in the house and kick it with my kids before they fall out. If I didn't get to your questions, I do apologize. You guys asked a lot of great questions. If you're in the country, you get Coco. All right, perfect. So I think we're pretty much done. A lot of great questions, a lot of great points. I'm going to try to do another live, at least two more lives this week, and I'm going to keep them basically focused around an idea. I think the next video I'm going to do is going to be how kennel clubs, how the acceptance of basically rustic breeds like the Cane Corso, the Borbo, the Dogo Argentino into kennel clubs kind of softened breeds. And you might think that that's a bad thing. I personally don't, and I will talk about that in the next video. But anyway, guys, thank you so much for taking some time out to spend the night with me. If you guys haven't, check out Bad Boys for Life. That's my man Roscoe and his homeboy Sigmund, a Rottweiler Doberman. You know, they're teaming up to clean up the streets of Miami and every other little drug-infested neighborhood on the planet. So check that out. And if you guys would, if you guys haven't, I mean, subscribe to the channel. If you have, if you are subscribed to the channel, please turn on notifications so that you guys are amongst the first to know, you know, when the video's dropping. All right, guys. So pretty much have a great night. I will talk to you very, very shortly. Peace.